been a year. Children of Israel have been encamped at Mount Sinai, Mount Horeb. They have received God's word. They have entered into a covenant relationship with God, and they have received God's commandments about how they are to live in right relationship with Him. They have brought freely of the spoils that they had when they left Egypt, as the Egyptians gave them silver and gold and other things that, to send them on their way. And the people brought freely, and they constructed the tabernacle of God. The tabernacle where God was going to dwell amongst them. That they could look and they could see that God's presence was there physically with them in a way that they could recognize. It wasn't in the shape of a golden calf. It wasn't in the shape of anything that had been created, whether it be animal or human or anything of that nature, but there was a pillar of cloud that stood above the tabernacle, a pillar of cloud that during the day was there and they could see the cloud, and at night it was a pillar of fire and they could see the fire. And once again, God's presence is there and nothing is burned, but you see the fire of His presence. And now it is time for them to travel. It is time for them to leave Mount Sinai, and they leave the place of worship, the place where God has met with them, and they head towards the promised land. They head towards that land where God has promised Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob that their descendants would have the land. The iniquity of the Amorites has been fulfilled. It has been overflowing. And God is going to take His people into His land. And there He is going to punish those who have desecrated His land where He has put His name. And so the people start out. And as they start out, they start out not with joy, not with happiness, not with celebration, looking forward to the couple of months it's going to take them to get from Mount Sinai up to Kadesh Barnea, where they're going to be able to go into the promised land. They start out not with expectation. They start out with grumbling. They aren't happy. You notice on page 72, at the top of the page there, as we see the story, and the rabble with them began to crave other food. Notice how easy it is for us who are trying to follow God's direction, who are walking in God's way, who are going towards a place that God wants us to be. We're going towards the promised land. I wish we had in our hymn book, "I am bound for the promised land," but we don't have it in our hymn book. I looked for it. I was going to sing it at the end. Or we were going to sing it at the end. But the thing of it is that they, here they are. They're getting ready to go. They come out of the land of captivity. They come out of the land of hardship. They come out of a place where they were being mistreated, where they were being killed, and they're looking forward to going to that place where God, and they start out grumbling. And notice that it's the rabble among them, as my wife said, coming down. It's the rabble amongst them. You know, when the children of Israel left the land of Egypt, they weren't all children of Israel that went out. When they left the land of Egypt, they had with them strangers and foreigners. They had with them slaves that they had from other nations. They had with them people who were their servants, who were their workers, who had come to recognize God in their midst. And these people were going out, but the rabble began to complain. You know, it only takes one person complaining about a situation to get everybody else grumbling. How easy is it for us who have been focused on one thing as believers? We've been focused on trying to get something done, and then somebody starts to grumbling. They don't like the way it was being done, or there's something that they don't like, or something that upsets them. And these people began to crave other food. Now, for a year, God had been feeding them. Every morning, they get up, they go out and pick up the manna, the bread from heaven, they eat it. They do all kinds of things with it on the Sabbath day, or on the sixth day of the week. They go out and they pick up 2 days worth of manna, and they have something to eat. They've got water. God has given them water. God has given them food to eat. But the rabble start looking back to the past. How often do we start looking to the past and say, oh, how good it was back then? I remember back then when I was a kid growing up in South Georgia, and I lived in a little small house. It probably was only 800 square feet, if anything like that. Had a 4 furnace in the center of the building. And I look back on my days, and yeah, those were good days. But you know, I had some hardship in that little house. My mother didn't like the way I did the bed, so she remade my bed every morning. I remember my mother getting her hands stuck in that wringer washer. You know what I'm talking about? 2 rollers up there, and her hand went through. They weren't all good times, but here the rabble are saying, hey, look, it was far better back over there. We got to eat fish. We got to eat cucumbers. We got all of these nice things. Now, wait a minute, folks. Stop and think about that. They were slaves. They were having to make bricks. They were having to build buildings and whatever else. And then at the end, they were having to make the same amount of bricks and still get their straw and everything else. And was the good old days the good old days? No, not really. But they look back on it. And they complained. And they wanted food. And they got not only, the rabble got not only the children of Israel complaining, but they got Moses complaining as well. God, why did you give me these people? Why did you make me responsible for them? Why are you doing this to me? I've been here faithful to you. I've been trying to do everything you want me to do. And now, what have I done to displease you that you put the burden of these people on me? Did I conceive these people? Did I give them birth? Why do you tell me to carry them in my arms as a nurse carries an infant? They're crying out for meat. Where am I going to get the meat, God? Moses is trying to understand what all's going on. And God says, Moses, I'll give you meat. I'm going to give your people meat. Moses says, where are you going to get it, God? I got 600,000 men around me. Now that's just the men. It doesn't count the women. Doesn't count the children. Doesn't count others that are teenagers. It's just 600,000. Lord, we ain't got enough flocks. We ain't got enough cattle. We ain't got enough goats. We ain't got enough sheep to give meat to all of these people. Even there's not could give them all enough to eat, God. How are you going to give them meat? You know, I can remember a time when another man was faced with a crowd of people. But he only had 5,000 men that he had to contend with. Now I know I'm jumping ahead of the story, okay? I understand that, okay? But I can remember another time when a man by the name of Jesus tested his disciples and said, hey, where are we going to get the food to feed these 5,000 men? Five loaves, two fishes later. The crowd had been fed and there's baskets of food left over. But that's ahead of the story. But now God says, okay, these people want food. All right, I'm going to give them meat. And I'm going to give them enough meat that for 30 days, not one day, not next tomorrow or next tomorrow, as we would say in Africa, but for the next 30 tomorrows, I'm going to give them meat. I'm going to give them quail to eat. They're going to have so many quail, they're going to have so much meat to eat that they're going to be vomiting, they're going to be throwing up, they're going to be doing all kinds of other things because they're going to get sick of the food I'm going to give them. They want meat to eat, I want to give it to them, Moses. Until it comes out your nostrils. You know what it's like when you throw up from having too much, getting engorged and give them the meat. And sure enough, God sends the quails. And the quails come. And the quails surround the camp. Now you can imagine how many tents and all for 600,000 men and their families. You can imagine how big of an area that must cover. And God sends enough quail so that when you walk a day's journey from the center of the camp, you're still walking in quails. 3 feet high and rising. Now, it says they were two cubits, about 36 inches. 2 cubits deep. And Jenny told me this morning, coming down, that she was listening to one preacher, and he was talking about the fact that God put the meat within the strike zone. That anybody could just reach out and grab a quail and get ready to cook it to eat it. They were in the strike zone. They were right there, handy. The weakest person gathered or got 10 homers. The ball was in the strike zone and every one of them got 10 home runs. 10 homers. Now that's what the other preacher said. When Jenny said it, it was far funnier than what I said. But you can imagine. Okay? Here they have everything they need. God has given it to them. And a plague breaks out because they have eaten too much. And they die. And then Miriam and Aaron, they get in on this grumbling. How easy is it in a church for a person who is dissatisfied with the pastor, or with the Sunday school teacher, or with the deacon, or with the pianist, or with the choir director? How easy is it for someone who says, oh, I can do a better job than they can? Why do we have them? Why can't we do it? You know, brothers and sisters sometimes look at each other and say, huh, mom treated you better than they treated me, she treated me. I'm just as good as you are. You see, once we start grumbling, once we start turning our eyes and looking around at individuals and at circumstances, we can lose sight of the fact that God is up here and God has a plan. God knows exactly what He's doing. God chose a man that could lead His people. A man that had been prepared for 40 years in the palace of the Pharaoh, a man who had been prepared for 40 years in the wilderness to know where all the watering holes were, to know where all the grassy spots were. He chose a man that He could use for His glory and to lead His people. But Aaron and Moses weren't, or not Aaron, Aaron and Miriam weren't happy in their role that God had assigned them to play. They wanted to be Moses. And God sets them straight. When we are tempted to turn against the leadership that God has given to us, then we are violating God's plan. We are looking not at God's story, at God's upper level intentions. We are looking at ourselves. And we're looking at what is happening and what we think we can do better than God. Miriam becomes a leper as God's punishment for their rebellion. And God says, listen to my man. Listen to the one that I speak with face to face. Sometimes I know I have complained about our leadership in the convention. When I was a missionary, I complained about other things. But you know, as I think about it now and I look back on it now, and even as I look at the story of my life in Walmart and what's happening there, and the leadership that we have there. You know, sometimes I think I could do it better. I have a lot of questions. I don't understand. I thought I could do it better as a missionary. I don't know. But there were those times that I was rebelling against leadership. And I was like Miriam and Aaron. I've been in churches that split because they didn't like a pastor. Or that something was happening. I remember as a young person, the first time I was ever in a church split, we had a pastor who was from Scotland, and he had Scottish brogue. I don't know how to do it. I'd never learned how it, but he had the brogue. He had the Scottish accent. And the church was growing, but some people didn't like what he was doing. And I remember as a teenager watching that church fight and listening to the adults complaining about the man that we had called to be our pastor. And he had the youth on his side, believe me. But we weren't listened to because the adults were listening. You know, we need to stop and move back. And I say that I'm preaching to myself as much as I'm talking to you, okay? Sometimes we just need to step back and say, okay, God, I don't understand this. But God, You're in charge. You have the leadership in place in our convention that You want. I may think that there was manipulation and other things going on, but God, you're in charge. And if you don't want that person to be there, you're going to take care of it. Finally, as we go through, we come to the point where the children of Israel get to Kadesh Barnea. And they are told to send out a group of men to spy out the land. They were given a group of men to go out so that they could see what the land was like. Now remember, none of these men, including Moses that had been down in Egypt, had ever seen the promised land that God was going to give his people. They had no idea what that land looked like. They could see, they could stand at the southern edge of the land and they could look north and they could see on the western side as they were looking north, they could see the Sea of the Mediterranean Sea if they were up on a high enough mountain. They could see the Mediterranean Sea. They could see the road that went up along the coast, the way of the sea that people transferred up and down on the coast. It was a nice, smooth, Shephelah type of area, and people could travel, caravans could travel. They could see that. They could see the mountains, and then they could see the mountains descend into the Judean wilderness. They could see a certain part of the land. But God said, send these men in so that they can look at the land and even bring back food from the land that I am going to give you, and you will have a plan of attack because I'm going to lead you into this land. I have brought you here. I'm going to give you this land. I'm going to use you to punish the people that are living in my land because they have desecrated my land. And I'm going to use you to punish them. And the children of Israel are sitting there at Kadesh Barnea, and for 40 days they are waiting for these 12 men to come back. And when the 12 men come back, they bring a report. Hey, the land is truly flowing with milk and honey. The land is wonderful. In fact, we brought a cluster of grapes just to show you what the land provides. And it was two men holding a pole, and the cluster of grapes was between the two men. Aha! God has a perfect place for them to live. Everything they need, everything they desired from Egypt has now been placed in front of them. Hey, we got food galore. There's only one problem. The people that live in the land have fortified cities. They're giants. We're ants. We can't go in and defeat them. They'll wipe us out. We'll all die if we try to go into the land. Now that's what 10 men said. Two men stood up. One was Caleb, and one was Joshua. These two men said yes. All of the difficulties that have been explained to you are real. They are true. It will be impossible for us to capture the cities. It will be impossible for us to go up and to do and to take the land. However, Caleb and Joshua said, it's not in our power to do it, but it is in God's power to do it. God can do anything He sets His mind upon, and He can use us to do what He wants done in His land. You know, He can use us in St. John just as well. We can invite people to come and we can get discouraged. And we can say, there's no way. You know, it's hard. But in all of the young people that I've talked to, it's hard for them as well. Because young people today don't have a place to worship. They don't have a place to go. They don't have a future to look forward to. You know, Jenny came back and she was telling me some things after her trip down to Texas, and she was telling me some things. And I look at what she was saying, and she was talking about the government and some of the things that the government's doing, and we look and we say, oh, how can we bring up children in this world? How can we have, what does the future hold for our grandchildren or our great-grandchildren? And we look and all we see are giants facing us. That's what we see. And we worry about our grandchildren, and we worry about our great-grandchildren and our great-great-grandchildren and whatever else that might be coming up and into the world and what the things are that they're going to be facing. And yes, it looks dark and bleak and giants in front of them. But you know what? If they've got God on their side, they're going to be victorious. God's got a plan for them. God's got something that He intends for them to accomplish. I don't know what it is, but I do know that God can do it. Caleb and Joshua stood up and said, God can do it using us. Yes, we are feeble. Yes, we are stiff-necked. Yes, we are stubborn. Yes, we don't trust in God. Well, we've seen all of these things that God has done. Yes, we are weak. But God can do it. And the people took up stones to stone. And so, God says, people, I heard what you said. All of you who are 20 years of age or older, all 600,000 of you men, your wives and your children are going to die in the wilderness. They're not going to die taking the land. They're going to die wandering in the wilderness. Because you did not have faith in me. And so for 40 years, the children of Israel wandered from place to place throughout the desert of Sinai. And there they died. Some died as results of rebellion, continuous rebellion against God when He brought plagues of illness. Some died as a result of the sin that they committed with the Moabite women. There's a lot of different stories that go on during this 40 years of wandering. And that's much like our lives. You know, when we accept Christ in our lives as Savior, we don't immediately enter into the promised land. We enter into the kingdom of God, yes. But we don't immediately enter into that final destination of the promised land of heaven, because we end up walking on earth. We end up wandering from one place to another. We end up sometimes distrusting God and complaining to God about all the miserable parts we have down here on this story. And we forget that God has a plan for each of us. And God has an ultimate destiny that we are going to arrive at. And during the time of our wandering, Rather than complaining and groaning, we need to be rejoicing and seeing the power of God that He can use and work through us as we reach out into St. John, into Stafford County, into Kansas, to the state of Kansas. You know, we as Christians are complaining about all the different things that are happening in the world and that are happening to, oh, poor us. And instead of complaining and looking and seeing the darkness to sin, we ought to be becoming proactive and reaching out and touching the world around us with the good news of Jesus Christ. This morning I was looking on the internet. I always look at the news just to see what's happened during the day, if something has happened. And I came across two different little articles. One concerned 15 movie stars that are regular attenders in a worship service of some sort. It might be, and they're not all Christian, don't hear me, but they're Jewish. They go to a Jewish synagogue, they go to some kind of service. And then there was 20 that didn't believe that God existed. Okay? Now, what's the point of that? The point of that is this. You and I know that God exists. You and I know that God is capable of doing a lot of things. And you and I and the evangelical Christian world ought to start relying upon Jesus Christ and upon God and His ultimate plan to start doing what we should be doing, rather than looking at fear in the world around us and all the things that are bad and all the things that are happening, all the oppression that's coming, all the persecution. Rather than focusing our eyes on the earthly story, we need to be focusing our eyes on God and letting God show us exactly what He wants us to do. Let's pray. Father, we look at the story of the wandering of Your people through the land and the desert of the Sinai. And Father, it is so easy for us to look at this story and condemn the people of Israel that rebelled against You, that complained against You, that groaned, that did not trust in You. We can say to them, and we can say in our minds and in our hearts, Lord, how could they be so dumb? How could they not trust in You? They ate the quail, they ate the manna. Their shoes did not wear out for 40 years. They didn't have any medical problems for 40 years as far as roaming around in a desert. Their clothes did not fall apart after 40 years. And we look at them and we say, how could they be so stiff-necked? And yet, Father, as we look at today's world, and as we look around us as Christians, we can see all of the difficulties. We can see everything that is going wrong. And we can be scared. We can be terrified. We can be afraid to go in and to fight and to speak for You and on Your behalf and to stand up and to be counted. We can be terrified of that, Lord. And yet, Father, in recognizing that we have no power within ourselves, we recognize, Father, that You are all powerful. And that You will show us what You want us to do and where You want us to go and how You want us to share Your word with those around us. Father, Give us strength. Give us energy. Give us power. Not from our own strength, but from your strength. And Father, where you lead, take us and lead us. Take our lives, Father, and lead us. Teach us and send us. Not in our strength, not in our knowledge, but in your power. For it is in your Son's name I do pray.